yet. Well, good morning, St. Paul family. My name is Brian Gath. I am the associate pastor of St. Paul Community United Methodist Church, and I've made it my career in the church as being associate pastor, and if you've studied the Latin and the Greek, then you know that associate pastor means he or she who is but one heartbeat or positive COVID test away from being called on to preach. Last night at 7:30, Pastor David called me with an elaborate scheme. He had tested positive again for COVID, which means that he might be contagious, and he had an elaborate scheme. There was something about a giant hamster ball and coming up the back and then not talking or looking at anybody. But I said, no, I am qualified to take your sermon, butcher it, and yet God will still work through it. These are my favorite sermons to give. I've done this before. I've stepped up in the middle of a service before, filling in for a senior pastor who couldn't go on. These are my favorite sermons because it starts out with his words. I change whatever it is that I want. You got the Holy Spirit mixed in there. So anything that you like, know that Pastor David is working on it. Anything you don't like, that's probably me. And if you hear anything from God, it is indeed God working miraculously before us. I think it's great. We're doing this on the same day that we have the Get Up Choir. No practice from the preacher, no practice from the choir. This is going to be an amazing day. In all seriousness, I'm excited for worship today. We have a three-legged dog. We've got Larry Flint. And we've got tax collectors. What better way could we honor and worship God than this? Let us begin with our morning's prelude. As you are able in body or in spirit, will you stand and join me in our call to worship? I offer praise in the great congregation because of you. Let all those who are suffering eat and be full.
Let all who seek the Lord praise Him.
I pray your hearts live forever. As we continue our worship now, we turn to a time of prayer, and in preparation for that, I invite you to look on the back of your program or on the screens in front of you. There are a list of names. This is just some of the folks who are in need of prayer this morning, and they've asked you to lift them up before God and intercede on their behalf. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, we woke up today and it was raining. It's kind of nice sometimes to wake up that way. But we have neighbors not far at all from us for whom the rain has been an incredible curse. More than 25 of your children of all ages have died in flooding in Kentucky. Places ravaged by poverty, ravaged by the opioid epidemic, ravaged by the ways that we have changed how we use our resources. How they wake up today, many are still missing loved ones. More still are wondering how they're going to dig out and muck out, where they're going to live and how they're going to make a living. Elsewhere in our country, wildfires are ravaging the earth. People are fleeing before them. Nature is being burnt. Almighty God, it makes me wonder how many times we must see these things before we will act differently. Currently in our world, there are many people who are hungry, some because they've lost their jobs, others because their countries can no longer grow enough to feed them. And because of war, where the countries that have often exported their bounties to feed those who are in need, those exports are being held up by warships and rocket fire. God, we pray for those who are hungry. I wonder how many times we're going to have to hear about them before we will act. We mentioned those who are in areas facing war this morning, people waking up to the sound of air raid sirens, people who children have gone off to war, the young men, the middle-aged men, the old men have gone to protect their homes and left behind people to care for themselves, never knowing when a bomb is going to come. Almighty God, how long must this war go on before we do something? God, this morning we recognize that there are people who are ill. Some, they're waking up and wondering when they're going to get better. COVID lasts much longer than we expect. Others have been dealing with diseases that have affected their lives for years, and they wonder when things will get better. Other folks have received diagnoses today or this week. And in a moment, in an instant, their outlook on the next years has changed. God, bring them hope. Bring them comfort. As they learn about their illness, as they learn about the treatments for it, let them know that they do not walk alone. But you walk with them, and your children, this congregation, walks with them as well. Mighty God, today as we worship, we recognize that there are people who are lonely, some who are right here physically with us, but for whom relationships are not as deep as they would like. And for many who are watching us online, who are unable to get out, unable because of their own frail bodies, or perhaps more likely because of fear of contracting sickness, God, may we reach them. May they know our love and our care. May they know that they are not forgotten. May they know that you love them and you are with them. Almighty God, there seems to be a lot going on in this world, but we face away from the idea of despair because we know that you are in charge. We know that your love is great enough to cover all transgressions, that you seek to be in relationship with all of us, and that your love for us will chase us to the highest points and the deepest depths and call us back to your side. For this, we are deeply grateful. And we remember this as we pray the prayer your Son taught his disciples by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Oh Lord, you're wonderful. Your touch is all I need. And when your hand is on this child, your healing I receive. Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I seek. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me.
I wanted to let you know that you shouldn't be worried, that you don't know all the things that are going on here. It would take a full-time list of reporters to catalog everything that this congregation does, and Don's been given the admirable job of trying to list some of those for us. Will you welcome him?
Thank you, Brian. If you'd notice in the bulletin today, we put a list together that may not be complete because I was looking at this earlier, and there is an omission. Habitat for Humanity is not there. And Bert and Charlotte have been involved with that for years. Thank you very much. So as I go through this, I'm not going to go through everything. I just want to thank everyone that has been involved in any fashion whatever with some of these ministries in the church. From the our house with her refugees here, the inn, with Lisa, caramel making, with Friend Plum, which we've done every year as well. Interfaith Hospitality Network, Found House. We have not participated here in the last couple of years because of COVID. And they're asking us now that we've reached near the end of the summer, think about next year already. So we have to think as a congregation how we feel about hosting the people at Interfaith Hospitality, meaning we'll house those folks, feed those folks for, let's say, 1 week at a time. We are talking about other things such as needs. You've heard from Judy Stagney a number of times regarding needs, and they're doing a drive that ends next week, the 7th. There are envelopes out here if you want to support needs, not only with your contributions that will be distributed in the form of gift cards, etc. Think about that. MEEC, which is Madison Educational Assistance Corporation in Madisonville. You have boxes in the church for needs, for MEEC. Also, Matthew 25 Ministries. You've heard about that a lot. In fact, on the television here recently with the flooding in eastern Kentucky, they will be sending a team there to help in distribution of foodstuffs and helping that area because it's been devastated, as Brian has mentioned. We have supported Jamaica Students Ministries as well, Gifts from the Heart over the years, Picnic in the Pastures, which is right on top of us. So think about that. There's a sign-up sheet for the remaining couple of weeks with David and the pastors. Bible studies. Thank you for David and for Jean and anyone else been involved with Delvine and Dale as well. When we finish this, I want you all to stand up if you've been involved in any of those ministries. Also, a Thursday prayer group, monthly healing services, mission trips with Kelly Getze and that group. Kelly will be around at the end of the service. Have any questions of Kelly? Even though we haven't listed all those things they've been involved in the last year, they've been involved very much with a number of things. Also, outreach, family events in the spring and fall, and we thank those folks involved. Thanks, Brian, and all those people that are involved in that area. I mentioned, Habitat for Humanity. Also, ministry shut-ins. There's a weekly service at the Seasons, and there's monthly fellowship at Twin Lakes and the Seasons. There's outreach ministries. If you notice, and maybe you haven't noticed, but in a closet, or hanging hanger coats up as you enter the church, there are boxes for used eyeglasses. These eyeglasses are used for third world countries, and they take a look at the prescription and distribute those glasses. So don't throw your old eyeglasses out. They can use those. Dead batteries, prescription pill bottles. And if you haven't noticed or had paid attention to some of these things, we are hosting other groups in the facility, in the church, on a weekly basis. And that is Al-Anon, Alcoholics Anonymous, American Heritage Girls. You just had a group from the Dixie Domes here in the last couple weeks. They rehearse here, as well as a Dulcimer group. Music auditions are done here. United Methodist Women also supports We Joy Sing. Emmaus activities. We have hosted now for a couple years Emmaus, which is a spiritual weekend that I was involved in here several years ago. We house those folks, as well as we have monthly meetings for Emmaus. Hamilton County elections. I don't know if you knew this, but we also are a focal point for the elections for our church. And that's available, every election period. Also, we hosted Good Pie You All, had cooking camps, and Pinewood Derby. You know, the thing that I will tell you is that as you look at this list, you may have been aware of all these things. There may be other additions we may add. But I want to thank everyone here specifically, individually, to you that have been involved. You've been involved because we can't do this without you. Your support, through your gifts and your helping during those functions is so very important. So if you talk to people at the end of the service and you seek out people that have been involved, please say hi, thank them all for their help each and every time. So before I forget, stand up if you've been involved in any of these ministries. Anybody, everybody, stand up, any of the ministries, okay? Take a look around you. Take a look around you with those ministries that people have been involved. Amy Bernard, Kent Cunningham, Joseph, everyone. And we appreciate the music also from our staff and right here, with Tom. And also, this morning it was wonderful, your piano. So thank you all. Thank you from Michael and everyone in this congregation. We can't do it without you. Thanks again.
If you haven't yet had an opportunity to be part of one of those ministries and you are interested in doing so, see Don or any of the people standing up around you. They will tell you what their favorite is and how you might become involved in that. Our scripture lesson today comes not from whatever it says in the program, but rather from the Gospel of Luke. I'll be reading chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. All the tax collectors and sinners were gathering around Jesus to listen to him. The Pharisees and the legal experts were grumbling, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Jesus told them this parable. Suppose someone among you had 100 sheep and lost one of them. Wouldn't he leave the other 99 in the pasture and search for the lost one until he finds it? And when he finds it, he's thrilled and places it on his shoulders. When he arrives home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Celebrate with me, because I found my lost sheep." In the same way, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who changes both heart and life than over 99 righteous people who have no need to change their hearts and lives. May this be for us this morning, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Recently, what are you going to do if you don't have enough singers? Well, that certainly is a definite possibility in the season we're in with all that's happening, but look at this. Isn't this a lovely group? So I choose music based on a number of things. One is, like on a get-up choir, it's something either that's very easy to sing or something I think that the singers will be familiar with. So I asked this group if any of them knew the song we're doing today.
Because we are in something more than a storm. We're in a war. We are in a moral war in this country and in this world. And the eternal moral pillars that God set in the universe, there are those who are seeking to destroy, tear down those moral pillars. And if there's any group that's under assault in any and every respect, it is our ladies, our women, our young girls. It's a storm out there. And so that's part of the reason that I selected this, because it speaks to the moment and it speaks to this part. So we ask you just to sit back, take a deep breath, and worship. This is an anthem of testimony.
Okay.
As long as there have been children in the world, I guess the question has been asked, what do you believe? And for at least the last 2,000 years, Christians have struggled to put into words what it is they believe. And I tell you what, it's hard to do in just a couple hundred words. But I invite you to join me in the Apostles' Creed, one of the statements of belief of our church. Will you recite with me? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, today I get the pleasure, an unexpected pleasure, of continuing the sermon series that Pastor David began a few weeks ago, talking about the story in pictures, talking about the amazing stained glass windows that we have here in our church. And today we're talking about the Christ windows and what the stories are that it's included in them. But as Pastor David likes to do, he wanted to start off with a joke today. Now, as a father and as a son, I know what dad humor is, and I embrace it. I think it's really good. But I think Pastor David has ascended to a higher level of granddad humor. And so I want you to keep in mind that this is his joke. There once was a missing dog sign on a utility pole. You've seen them before. It's got a picture of a dog and a description underneath and a big monetary reward for return of this animal, this precious family member. The description of the dog went like this: missing front right leg, blind in left eye, left ear gone, tail permanently crooked after it was hit by car. Accidentally neutered by electric fence, almost deaf. The sign concluded, answers to the name Lucky. Lord help us. What a crazy thing to name a dog with all of that that's happened to it, Lucky. Now, I suppose you name the dog first, and then, you know, all these things happen to it, but maybe not. Maybe they picked it up at the shelter and decided to name it Lucky after that. But how could you think of a dog like that and think that it's Lucky? Well, to know that even and despite all those things that have happened to it, to know that someone cares enough for that animal to put up a sign and to offer a reward, isn't that truly the definition of lucky? And isn't that, as we think of God through Christ acting, isn't that what redemption is all about? So in the scripture today, we have Jesus hanging around, and he's hanging around with a group of maybe what are unlucky people, these tax collectors and sinners. Now remember, tax collectors are especially hated in their society. These people have a terrible reputation. They're fellow Jews, folks from Israel who have been conscripted, well, or hired by the Roman government to collect taxes from their neighbors. And what's especially interesting is they each were told what it was that they had to turn over to the Roman government, but they got to keep anything else that they collected. And so they extorted their neighbors, their families, to provide their own income. Now, the religious leaders of that day, they couldn't grasp why Jesus was doing this. It made absolutely no sense because he was hanging out with outcasts, outlaws, and outliers. And to their way of thinking, a rabbi really should spend his time with the good people. In response to their criticism, Jesus told the story about a parable, about a sheep, this parable about a sheep that was unlucky enough to lose its way. Now, Jesus doesn't explain how this sheep lost his way, in part because it's obvious to everybody who knows sheep, and all the people who are listening to them know about sheep. Sheep are, well, they're not the smartest animals in the world. A few years ago, David and Kathy were traveling through Rocky Mountain National Park, and as they climbed up one of the hills, they saw what appeared to be a bighorn sheep standing precariously on the edge of a cliff. Now, this isn't their bighorn sheep, but if you've ever seen them, it's crazy how they get there. If you ever imagined that a sheep said, you know what, I'm down here, I think I'm going to go way up there and hang off the side of a mountain, you would know that that sheep is absolutely crazy. You know, bighorn sheep, they're great at maneuvering. They can get up and down these mountains with comparative ease compared to so many others. But there are occasions when these sheep get themselves stuck, and they get put into a position that they can't escape. Now, the reason this happens is because sheep are known to drift. They're focused on one thing, that's eating, and they put their head down and they nibble on a little bit of grass, and they keep it there until they've consumed that patch of clover, and then they look over here and, oh, here's another patch of grass, and then, oh, there's another one, and they keep going and they drift, keeping their heads down, and only when they finally look up do they realize that they've gotten themselves in a jam. By the way, have you ever woken up and realized that you have been adrift? Whether it's a relationship that you've had that started out wonderfully but is now something that you're not proud of, or whether it's a job that you began, or an organization that you joined that you believed in totally at one point, but as time has gone on, it has slowly drifted from where you started to where you are now, and it no longer pursues the goals that you were once so passionate about. You know, we Christians are not immune to drifting. If nothing else, the pandemic has taught us how easy it is to become disconnected from the church. There was a recent study that showed that it takes just 10 weeks for someone who is a frequent attender at church, a frequent worshiper as a part of a congregation, it takes them just 10 weeks to stop coming. After a couple of weeks, and then a few more, and then if they come back, they find that they don't feel like they belong anymore. They have drifted. The things around them feel different. Somebody's moved the name tag sign. There's a new person greeting folks at the door. This is the problem of drifting. And frankly, let's face it, drifting never leads to anything good in life. Drifting will not lead you to a holy life. It won't lead you to be physically fit. It won't lead you to morality or a healthy body or a good marriage. You know, I like to talk about sometimes my wife accuses me of not knowing where I'm going. It happens less now that there's GPS and Siri yelling at me the whole time, but especially in the times beforehand when I was just dealing with a map, I would be going somewhere and the road would get crowded and it would look like something was going on. I'd get off at an exit and she'd say, "Where are you going?" And I say, "I don't know, but I'm making good time." If you don't know where you're going, if you don't have a destination in mind, if you're just drifting, chances are you're going to end up in a not-so-great place, and you're going to have to work to get back to where you want to be. The bad news is that we are prone to drift, but thankfully there is good news for us drifters. The good news is that no sheep will ever become lost enough or trapped enough to escape from the grasp of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Jesus makes it clear that God loves each of us, each of you, each of God's creation, so passionately that he sent his Son to rescue us from our bent toward self-destruction. This is the good news for drifters. There's no hopeless cause. There's no fool's errand. There is no one, I repeat, no one who will fall beyond the reach of God's grace, not now. Not ever. There's an old Jewish story that describes just how grieved God's heart becomes when a sheep from his fold goes up missing. The story tells of the great celebration in heaven that occurred at the night that the Israelites escaped from their Egyptian slave holders. You remember the Moses led them through the dried up sea, and when the Israelites had passed, the waters came and they drowned the Egyptian pursuers. Well, there was a party in heaven that night. Everyone was having a great time, the story goes. Everyone except God. And one of the angels elbowed the archangel Michael and said, What's wrong with God? Isn't he happy? Isn't this what we wanted to do today? Isn't this what we wanted to accomplish? Why isn't God celebrating with us? And Michael answered, God is not celebrating because God is weeping. You see, many thousands of his children were drowned today. Isn't it strange that people we consider to be our enemies are in reality God's friends? We rejoice at the downfall of the people we consider our adversaries, and yet they are the very ones for whom God cries. You know, as a Christian and as a preacher especially, there's a temptation to point out all the people who have lost their way, who have either drifted from God's word who have never accepted it. It's tempting, really, to condemn them. There's no better sermon than one that talks about them. As long as it's not us, as long as it's them, as long as it's pointing to somebody else, it will make the congregation feel good, it'll make you feel good. There's nothing better, really, than to be comforted in the knowledge that my sins, your sins, are not quite as bad as them, as theirs. It's a great way to get a congregation on our side. We love to hear about people who have drifted farther than we have, whose sins we think are somehow greater than our own. Yet I say here today that there is no message less Christian than that one. The true Christian message, the message given to us by Jesus' words, and perhaps most importantly by his actions, is the one that reaches out to those people who aren't part of the church. Jesus didn't spend his time with the good people. Jesus spent his time with the people on the margins. He befriends them. He welcomes them. He reminds them and teaches them that they are fellow children of God. Pastor David likes to remind us that the church is the only institution in the world that exists for the sake of the non-members. It exists primarily for folks that aren't yet in the congregation of faith. And how are these outsiders going to experience the love of Jesus unless it is we who are here who love them? How will someone else come to accept the teachings of Jesus unless we teach them? How will they come to faith in Christ unless we walk with them? These are all great questions, but the real question is the one that's been posed before. Will you allow your heart to break over the people for whom Jesus' heart breaks? Will you join God in mourning the deaths of the slaveholders? Pastor David closed with this story. He said that you probably don't associate the name Jerry Falwell with Larry Flint. Well, Jerry Falwell's son, Jonathan, describes a conversation between the Baptist preacher and the publisher of Hustler magazine. You see, years ago, Jonathan went with his father to Florida, where the senior Falwell was debating Larry Flint. They were having a kind of a show, one side versus the other. And after the event, Jonathan recalls Mr. Flint asking his father if he could get a ride back to Virginia with him on Mr. Falwell's private jet. Now Jerry, the pastor, says, yes, sure, come with us. And so they traveled to the airport and boarded this beautiful black and gold Gulfstream 3. As they flew to Virginia, Jonathan sat across from his father and Mr. Flint as they engaged in a long conversation. They talked about sports. They talked about good food and restaurants. They talked politics and family. Jonathan was frankly amazed. He was bewildered because they kept talking like these two were old friends and they had just been debating some very difficult moral questions. After they dropped Mr. Flint off in Lynchburg, Jonathan took his dad aside and said, how come you could sit on that airplane and have a conversation with that Larry Flint as if you were lifelong buddies? Dad, he's the exact opposite of everything you say you believe in. He does all the things that you preach against, and yet you were treating him like a member of your own family, a member of your own church. Why? Answers. 7:30 last night. Why, Dad, are you treating this man like this? And Jonathan says that his father's response changed his entire outlook on ministry. Jonathan, his father said, there's going to be a time one day when Larry is hurting and lonely. And Larry is going to look for help and guidance. And he's going to pick up the phone and he's going to call someone who can help him. And I want to earn the right to be that phone call. Like all of us, Larry Flint was lost, but he was not a lost cause. He was lucky enough to have a friend like Jerry Falwell willing to prevent Larry's luck from running out. So I wonder, who do you know in the world who is drifting? Who in your world can you help be named lucky? How can you, if you are drifting, be brought back into the relationship with Christ? Because the good news is that no matter how far it is that we have gone today, God through Christ is beckoning us to come to his side and will welcome us with open arms. Amen. Methodist Church, our vision is to live and love like Jesus, to make the world better for everyone. And if you want to help someone realize how lucky they are, let me first invite you to begin by connecting with us. Let us know that you're here today. There are connection cards in your program. There are connection cards online. If in some way you would let us know that you're here, just give us a name and even an email address. We might be able to begin to get to know you. And for those folks who are here every week, it helps us to care for you. On your way out today, you can leave those in the basket as you pass. We're receiving an offering today to support the ministries of St. Paul Community United Methodist Church. Many of the things, all of the things really that Don was talking about early are made possible by your generous giving. And we invite you to support them financially. Don't forget that NEEDS is having their student support fund drive, and there are special giving envelopes available for that on your way out today. You can leave your gifts and your offerings in the same baskets as your Connect cards. This week on Wednesday, we're having a service of healing, and we invite you to join us at 7 o'clock on Wednesday for that. Also wanted to let you know that there is no more lucky person than the one who receives a card from someone expressing care for them. And if you want to find the perfect card to express that that joy and that care, I suggest the cards that the women of the United Methodist Church are selling. There are pictures of our stained glass windows and our building, and they are a wonderful way to express to someone else that you care for them. Let us conclude our worship with our closing hymn.
To my soul.
As you leave here today, I realize that you're missing a leg and maybe your ear's missing and you're going blind in one eye. And if you're not, then someone that you see today no doubt is. Carry with you the message that they are lucky. Lucky because in Christ they can be redeemed. Lucky because in Christ they can be reunited with their Creator. So I invite you to go forth from this place holding fast to all that which is good. Surrender to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, the unlucky. Support the weak. Honor everyone. And love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Go in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.